since the morning hand was up from last Friday. Amen. So I know for that those individuals did have questions with anybody else, hand was up from last week that we overlooked. All right, so we have those three that hands were up from last week. Are there any new questions for this week? All right, this is the morning hands, Brother Jeff. For this week, Brother Jeff, this is the glory. All right, so we'll deal with the first three. First, Sister Sweeney, Sister Blair, Sister Lorna.
Can I make a quick announcement though?
What's that?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Let's thank the Lord.
That's right. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. My Lord. Yeah, that's right.
Every right. time a person comes through childbearing, we thank God.
Yeah.
His word gave us a promise that she will be saved in childbearing.
Amen.
She continues in holiness and sobriety. Is that right?
Amen.
The word said, many women have died during birth.
Yeah.
Children, so that's enough of the saints to rejoice in.
Amen.
The mama and the baby made it through the moment. Amen for that. Amen. There's no light thing whatsoever.
No.
Amen. So we thank God for that wonderful announcement we made. Amen. And then it was just like what the word of the Lord said. Amen. Spoken to her. Amen. Even as we testified before, that all her children were premature.
Uh-huh.
And all the children came months earlier. Amen. But this one hit it right on the nose.
Yeah.
Full time.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
2 days shy of 40 weeks.
My Lord.
49 weeks.
Right.
Thank you, Lord.
She would have been 40. That baby made it full term.
My Lord.
Wonderful Savior.
Amen.
And not only that, the doctors were trying today. Was supposed to be scheduled her C-section.
My Lord.
The doctors wanted to take the baby.
Lord, I thank you.
I didn't want to take the baby, but we prayed and she called me. Yesterday we talked a bit about it. I told her, I said, don't take the baby, we're gonna come when you wanna come.
Yes, yes.
I said, between today and Sunday.
Thank you, Jesus.
That baby showed on up today.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I know God got a way that's mighty sweet.
Yes, he does.
That's why I have no reason to doubt God.
None.
No reason not to trust God. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
The doctors don't know what they want to do.
Right.
Unless you are, amen. I want to take that baby. Schedule that C-section for today. Gonna cut that girl and that baby want to come out on his own.
Right. On his own.
God,
yeah.
At that time, amen. God knowing he ready, he'll come on out.
Yeah.
Amen. So folks always want to mess with God's business, you know.
Right. Man.
Amen. I thank God for a praying grandmother and a wise grandmother. She told my wife, she went with our kids. She said, I'm with the doctor. She said, don't let them take the babies. He said, let the babies come on their own.
Amen.
They know they're going to come.
Amen.
So, man, they come, now be ready.
Amen.
Let them doctors take that baby, you know. So sometimes doctors want to do God's job.
Yes.
Yeah, let baby know when it's ready.
Amen.
I'm glad to hear the wonderful testimony and the good news in the name of the Lord. All right. Let's go ahead and get to those questions. Amen. In the name of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Grace and peace.
Grace and peace you multiply.
My question is pretty basic. For so many years in 2 Kings, the second chapter, where it talks about Elisha, when he was going up to the mountain and the children yelled out, you know, go up, ye bald head, go up, ye bald head. And he turned around and cursed the children. And for so many years, we were taught that the she-bears, the two she-bears, actually killed the children. But the other day, I was told, someone said, no, they weren't killed. They were just mauled. So I was going to ask you, when I went to that scripture, it did say that the she-bears tear them. But is it that they died, or were they just mauled?
Well, first you have to find the definition of mauled.
Okay.
Find out what does the definition means what you said. 2 Kings, the 22nd chapter. Second chapter of 2 Kings. Let's find out what the scripture says. So, 2 Kings, second chapter.
near the end.
And let's go into the 23rd verse.
Mm-hmm.
22nd verse. We started at the 22nd verse.
Mm-hmm.
So the waters were healed unto this day, according to the saying of Elisha, which he spake. And he went up from thence unto Bethel. And as he was going up by the way, there came forth little children out of the city and mocked him, and said unto him, Go up thy bald head, go up thy bald head. And he turned back and looked upon them, and cursed them in the name of the Lord. And there came forth two she-bears out of the wood, and tare 40 and two children of them. And he went from thence to Mount Carmel, and from thence he returned to Samaria. All right, so where does the scripture say they mauled them?
Right, someone told me that because it said that he teared them up, they didn't die. They were just scratched up and torn. But I'm thinking if the she-bears tore them up, that they actually died.
I would think so too.
Right. Amen.
That's right.
Because there was a preacher on the radio that was talking about that. My husband and I were talking. I'm like, no, those children died. And he said, no, they were mauled. They didn't get killed. So, but I'm thinking just because they didn't say that they died, common sense would tell you that if they were torn apart, that there was no way they were going to be able to survive that.
Right, but and the word tear means to destroy,
mm-hmm.
to break down.
Mm-hmm.
So if you talk about using the same word tear and say the word that's equivalent to a tore down, then you're dealing with something that's been destroyed.
Right.
So I don't see how they would have come up with the conclusion that only it only just scratched them up,
mm-hmm.
and it didn't actually consume them. Mm-hmm. That's what we have to be careful with, people's interpretation being added to scripture.
Yes, yes.
And what we have to be careful with doing is putting our assumptions upon scripture.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what happens so many times in the church, and that's why we have so many false doctrines.
Amen.
Out here is because people add their assumption,
mm-hmm.
their personal opinion to the scripture. Right. Instead of just leaving the scripture at what it said. And so I would think that that the she bears, the two of them came out and it tore, as we said, those children. And if we can deal with a bunch of assumptions, because mm-hmm. I can assume and say because there were 40, how many were there? There were 42 children, so it was 42 children and only two she-bears. I can assume and say, well, it killed some of them,
mm-hmm.
and then the other ones barely got away, but they got away with a few scratches and bruises. So there's many interpretations you can add to that scripture,
mm-hmm.
And so therefore, that doesn't make my assumption correct because I wasn't there.
Amen.
And so
Amen.
My assumption only now becomes your opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And so I must see what the scripture says. So the
Amen.
Scripture says it tore. The scripture says it tore.
Mm-hmm.
And when we look at the word tear, normally it means to actually consume or to destroy something.
Amen.
So we can only go that far with the scripture. All right?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right, so we'll leave it in the scripture and what the scripture said. We're not going to add our own twists and opinions.
Amen.
All right, well, wonderful question, though.
Amen.
All right, good question. All right, Sister Lorna. All right. And ask your first question first. And then we'll wait and come back to your second question.
I don't need an answer.
For the first one. Okay, all right, so give the second one. Okay. Yeah.
I was talking to a friend, and she was saying how the members of her church, they use grape juice for communion because they're members that have or still struggles with alcoholism.
All right.
What is your take on using wine for communion? Because I felt that with doing it to the Lord, if it's done the correct way, there shouldn't be a problem.
Right. There are many people that give that same excuse to why they substitute the commune, while they substitute grape juice for wine when it comes to the communion of the Lord. And many of them say, well, you know, you got young people, you know, in the church, and people will come out of the world, and they still struggle with alcohol and things of that nature. So they use that as an excuse to why they converted over to grape juice. When, you know, we hear and when we're taught, brought up, we use wine, which is actually, when you really deal with it with an essence, it's really all the same thing. Because the grape juice and wine is the fruit of the vine. In fact, the wine is grape juice, just fermented.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, it really all is the same thing. One is fermented and one is not. So that's really all you're dealing with. But even when getting to that argument, though, as far as trying to justify why they don't use the wine, it's really a carnal explanation.
Amen.
And it really doesn't have any merit to it, because if, like you were saying, if they're doing it for the right purpose, for the right reason, yeah, I mean, come on, we only take that little bit in that cup. And so if that little bit gonna get somebody drunk, or it's gonna tempt somebody to go out now and go get a whole bottle and drink it, then they were not doing it the right way to begin with.
Amen.
And their mind was not where it was supposed to be. And so they should not have been partaking in communion to begin with.
Amen.
Because when you go to that table and you partake in that body, you partake in that blood, Jesus should be on your mind.
Amen.
So if Jesus is on your mind, and this is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, this is the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you cannot be thinking about the blood of Christ that redeemed you from your sin and be thinking about sin at the same time. You know, how can you think about the blood that has purged you from your sin, but yet you sit there looking at that time and say, man, I have to church tonight, I'm going to go get me a whole fifth of this. You know, it just don't make sense. So your mind would be in the right place. So that's a carnal, lazy type of excuse for that. And so therefore, it wouldn't have any merit. So I would say that if your people are dealing with that, you should be giving them communion anyway.
Right.
Amen.
You know, so if you know that there are people that are struggling with something, and when you say struggling, that means they're currently still a participant in that, that they resort to it every once in a while. And so they resort to that every once in a while. They need to sit down and get themselves together before they should be partaking of the Lord's Supper anyway, you know, in the communion of the Lord. So it's a mind condition. So I wouldn't say that we need to convert to grape juice all because people are struggling with alcoholism, you know, and stuff like that. But, you know, I mean, it's just a lot of carnal stuff. The church world has gotten real carnal. You know, the church has really gotten carnal. And the reason why they stay carnal is because they only keep the people carnal. They only preach stuff to the people to keep them at a certain level. They're not constantly giving them that which is eternal, to put their minds on that which is eternal. Because if you're preaching and teaching for them to visually see what this thing is all about, you never run into that issue. You know, and so it goes to teaching, it goes to that preacher. So if you want to blame somebody, blame the preacher. You can't blame the people, because he should be keeping them in a spiritual mindset, especially when it comes to communion. All right? Well, yeah. Well, in the scripture, well, even when Melchizedek hit Abraham after coming from the slaughter, and Melchizedek, the priest of God, met Abraham, and he gave him bread and wine. And all these things was establishing the new covenant. It was establishing the law at that present time. It was bringing in that priesthood. But then as we come over into this new covenant, that he takes from that which was established and he gives it a new meaning. So he doesn't take away what they were already accustomed to doing. They were already accustomed to eating the bread and the wine and doing all this during Passover, and when they were partaking in the Passover meal. And so all he did was take from the Passover meal what they were commemorating about the day when they were in Egypt, when he said, put the blood upon the doorpost. And when the death angel of the Lord said, right, the truth said, when I come through, he said, I will pass over all those that have the blood on the doorpost. And so they were commemorating the day of Passover when that transpired, and how the Lord protected them and passed over them and didn't kill their children. And so in commemorating that, now the Lord brings it out And he now wants them to commemorate him because how he's getting ready to go down that cross and shed his blood. So he brings it into a different meaning, into a spiritual meaning. And he's letting us now know that I'm the Passover lamb. And so in doing that, he still continues with what they were already doing.
Mm-hmm.
He just simply takes the bread off the table that was already sitting there to commemorate the Passover, and he takes the cup of the wine, and he said, this is the New Testament in my blood. Now he gives it a different meaning. But he continued with the same thing that he had already been doing. Which in actuality, we do not do communion the way that they did it in the Bible.
Mm.
1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. All right? 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. No, 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, rather. And around the, let's go to like the, start at the 30th verse. Man, that many verses, right? Let's start off the 30th verse or so. No, I want to further than that. Let's go to verse number 20. Right, verse number 20 of 1 Corinthians 11 chapter. So 1 Corinthians 11 chapter, verse number 20. And he said, when you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat the Lord's Supper. He said, for in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper. And one is hungry, and another is drunken. All right? Eat right then will show you the use of wine.
Amen.
Because the regular use of grape juice doesn't get nobody drunk.
Amen.
All right, so for him to utilize the usage of another is drunken in that manner, denotes that you know what type they were already using. They were using wine. All right, he said, for one is hungry and another is drunken. And he said, what have you not houses to eat and to drink in, or despise you the church of God, and shame them that have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. He said, for I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also, he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. But this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, and ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest I will set in order when I come. All right, now I want you to notice in verse number 20. He said, when you come together, therefore, one place is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before him his own supper. And one is hungry, and another is drunken. What have you not houses to eat and to drink in, or despise you the church of God? Now, even in commemorating the Passover, it was more of a festival.
Mm.
It was more of a celebration. And they would do it in the form of a meal, where everyone would come together and would actually eat. All right? So we do it in the midst of service, or we do it a little bit after service, and we come together and we just eat a little bread and do that. In their day, they were not accustomed to doing it the way that we do it, because remember, they're still having the mind of how they celebrated Passover. So because these individuals, when you look at the Apostle Paul, Apostle Peter, and all these brethren, you got to remember, they are still Jews. Now, women, they're still Jews. And so when you step into the Jewish mindset, they were still doing Jewish things, just with a spiritual understanding.
Amen.
So they knew that when they would partake upon this festival and would eat and everybody would gather around and come together, that
even though they were still kind of doing it in the same way they did Passover, they knew it had a different meaning to it. So they were still getting together, celebrating, eating, and they would sit there and they would feast in commemoration and remembering the death of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let me submit something else to y'all. The little cup that we drink, they did not drink out of those little cups. They actually had an entire glass of wine. Because that's what they would do at Passover. At Passover, the whole table would be spread. There would be a pitcher of wine in the middle of the table. And each person would have their own individual glass. And it would be poured from one glass into the other glass, into the other glass. And everybody had their own cup of wine. All right? That's why he could say, make the statement, when one eats before another, one is hungry and the other one has already eaten, and then another one is drunken, meaning somebody else is already, before the other one has come to the festival, somebody else has already done chugged down their meal and drunk their wine.
Amen.
All right? Amen. So the way that we even do it in the church is not how they did it then.
Amen.
All right?
So amen.
It pays to know the history of things. And knowing the history of things, we'll see the way we did it and the way that we currently do it today, in essence, we really get that from Catholicism.
Mm. Amen.
That's why they all did the one cup, did the wafers. If you look at the Catholic Church, that's the way I do it today.
Yeah.
Yep.
I took out the one cup and put a little priest, put a little wafer in their mouth. They come up to the little table, everybody come, kneel down and put a little wafer in their mouth. Everybody drink out the one cup. That's how they do it. So in essence, we got that little bit of tradition from Catholicism, because the way that the Jews actually commemorate Passover and the Lord's Supper is not the way we do it today. Anytime you have supper involved, that means an actual meal.
Right.
So how do you call it the Lord's Supper if you don't even have an actual meal? That's it?
Yeah.
All right, so this takes us to know history to know that we're really not even doing it in the same manner that they would do it. The best way for us to actually do it is how we get together and we're all in there eating and we have our meals set before us, and then in the midst of that meal, we partake and commemorate the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, while we're in the midst of our festivities. But that's not the way we do it here in the church.
Right.
All right? Mm. According to the scriptures, that's the way it was done.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
That's what Paul even explained for it to be done. All right. So that's why when we get into this type of stuff, there's a lot of curves, a lot of things that we have to iron out and really get back to the scripture. Many times we never investigate. Me and my wife were talking about this in the car. Many times we never really investigate things that we do in the church.
Amen.
We just do it and we just do it out of routine.
Out of custom.
Because we were taught to do it. We do it because it's what we're accustomed to doing it. And then we never really research it.
Amen.
Never really look into it. But if we really look into it, and we go back to doing it the way that the Jews did it during Passover, we find out the way that we're doing it is totally incorrect. All right? All right. Sister Williams has her hand up in the midst of the question. Brother Jeffrey has the mic in front of you.
Daniel diet?
Yes.
The
Daniel diet, or what they call the Daniel, been called the Daniel fast, the Daniel diet, is simply something that's taken from the book of Daniel, when Daniel and the young brothers that were taken away from Jerusalem went into captivity. And when they went into captivity, the Chaldeans and the kingdom of the Chaldeans wanted them to eat food just like everybody else was eating and drink like everybody else was drinking. But by them being Jews, they had a strict dietary law. They were not able to eat certain things. And so because they wanted to keep that dietary law, they told them, give us what we take, don't give us the king's meat, give us what we want to eat, and we'll show you that at the end of the 10 days, we'll look better than everybody else. And so it really wasn't a diet for Daniel and them, because that was their way of living. And that was their way of life. They had strict laws that came from God where they could not eat certain things. But we now call it a diet because, I mean, to be honest, none of us really eat like that anymore. And so that's why they call it a Daniel diet. And they just pretty much go back to eating what Daniel would eat. And so that's why we call it a Daniel diet. And so they use it for a spiritual cleansing and a natural cleansing. A lot of this stuff that they do eat on this Daniel's diet not only helps you see spiritually, but it does cleanse you out physically. We partook on it 1 year for 21 days. We did up until 21 days, and I lost how many pounds? I lost.
In the first couple days,
you lost 5 pounds. And like in the first couple days, I lost 5 pounds. Just like that, drop my weakness dropped, and it was a visible. It was a visible that you saw it falling off of you, because we weren't eating meats. We were eating red meats. We couldn't have sugars. We couldn't have starch. We couldn't have a lot of stuff. And within that first couple of days of doing it, I had lost 5 pounds, and I probably would have lost more, but I ended up having to go through. I ended up having a medical condition in the midst of it. Not a medical condition, but I ended up having a tooth that was bothering me, and so I had antibiotics. And antibiotics plus doing that was about to take me out of here. So I ended up having to go back to Cortland regular food in order to balance out. And so therefore, that kind of helped me just kind of stay there. But I probably would have lost a whole lot of weight, more weight, if we would have did the whole full 21 days without me eating nothing regular. Yeah. So to me, this is good. I think it's a good thing. We felt better. You know, it, not only that, it made you really look at what you eat. It really made you investigate and prepare meals. Sometimes we just slap meals together. You know, get the hamburger out the thing, just slap it in the pan, it's going wrong with it. But we really had to look at ingredients, we really had to prepare, we really had to, it really disciplined us. It really did show a lot of discipline. Because you got to look at the ingredients, you got to go. And the first couple of days, we were so messed up. Because we thinking, oh, it's organic, it ain't got this. And then we would read the ingredients and come to find out it had something that we couldn't have.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really wouldn't be organic to begin with. So even with that, a lot of y'all who eating organic stuff and you think, oh, it's organic, you still got to pay attention. And some of that stuff is not organic. They call it, it could be a sugar, but it's called something else. It's in another form. And so it's really not organic at the end of the day. And so it calls us to really investigate, to really get organic stuff. Stuff that didn't have no sugar. It could have bleached wheat.
Wow.
It could have lemon in it. It could have yeast in it. I mean, we had to look. We had to look at every detail to make sure none of this stuff was in there. And so it calls for great discipline. Yeah, it was a great discipline.
Yeah, because when we go to this church, they just finishing up, I think, Sunday.
Yeah.
And my daughter said she feels so much better. She thinks she said, I know I've lost weight, you know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
so, because I think, I don't know if they did it for 21 days or 14 days. I really don't know.
Yeah. But most churches do it at the beginning of the year.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I mean, coming to New York.
Okay.
Daniel's diet. Or actually, we were talking, I was thinking even about instituting it here around maybe like March. Somewhere around March, you do a 21 day and have a strict dietary thing. You'd be surprised. It helps you. It clears your memory. And it really just opens you up a lot to a lot of stuff. Because your body is releasing all those toxins.
Amen.
You'd be surprised how many toxins you're really putting in our body.
Yeah.
You know, through the foods that we eat and stuff like that. So it's a very good discipline. It's a very good discipline.
Very good.
Very good discipline. All right. Now, Brother Jeff, is your question. Sister Lorna, you was up with yours. Sister Blair had her hand up. Was about the same
thing. Sister Lorna was saying about the supper.
Uh-huh.
But now that we have a better understanding, are
we
going to do it that way? Should we do it that way, like once a year?
We can do it. I would say we can do it once, maybe once a month, or however we choose to do it. And it would be good to do it. But sometimes you just gotta kind of, work things over, because some people just, they're understanding not there yet. So God works with us where we are. And then once we get our understanding open and illuminated to things, then that's when the change must be made. And so by this being the first that we're hearing about, we'll institute as we go on. All right, so we can know how to prepare and how to go on and do things, okay? All right. All right, Brother first, and then Brother Jeffrey.
Yeah.
Yes, and then we can sit down and we'll have it set up. And what we'll do is we'll prepare it. Because for something like that, we will have to prepare it the night before. You know, so we'll set up, prepare the night before. As far as the whole setup and arrangement, prepare for it.